the Advocacy Director of Voices for Georgia's Children, and I want to welcome you to our Child Fatality Review Georgia Children's Advocacy Network panel discussion. I'm really excited to have you all here. The way it's going to work is we're going to do a few presentations on Child Fatality Review in general, and then the state data, and then the DFACS data, and then our Brain Trust panel will come up and take these seats and then talk a little bit about what each of their agencies does relative to the child fatality review process and data that they think are particularly important. And then we'll take questions from all of you. So there's some question cards. I hope everybody has some. Andre can pass some out. If you want to write some questions down as you think of them, hold them up and we'll collect them or pass them to the end of your row. And then we'll quiz you at the end. Anyway. So I'm going to go ahead and get us started because we have a lot of things to cover. Terry Covington is our first speaker. She is a national expert on child fatality review. You should have her bio in your materials there. So welcome, Terry. I'm going to step out.
Hello. I just want you all to know I get a prize for being here because I came from the Baltimore area. I should have really put a picture of my driveway on Sunday morning because we really couldn't, and I'm a Michigander, and when it started to snow, I said, people are making such a big deal of this. Oh my gosh, it was a big deal. We had 32 inches over about 24 hours. And I have a 29-year-old son who came over and kept saying, you know, I have a bad back. I said, hit that shovel. I am not doing it. So I was here last year as well when you launched your report, and when Arima called and said, could you come again, and Polly called, and I said, what do you want me to do? And they said, a little bit of the same. And so I am going to do a little bit of the same. Actually, unfortunately for me, I couldn't find my slides from last year, so I didn't create what I think you want to hear, which is I'm going to give you a little bit of an overview of child death review in the U.S., talk a little bit about the Georgia system and how I think it fits and how it functions in terms of comparing it to the national standard. And then talk to you a little bit about where I think your challenges are, where you need to forge forward. This is a big day for you because you're releasing your annual report. And congratulations on that, because a lot of states don't even get to the point of releasing reports from their child death review work. They do a lot of reviews. They put a lot of energy into it, and they don't move forward with the findings. So I really congratulate Georgia in being in a place today where you actually have a report in front of you with really, really important data that represents 500 plus children who died in the state of Georgia in the past year. That's a lot of kids.
Yeah.
Too many, actually, but I think you're getting better because your numbers have been increasing.
Sorry, guys.
Warmed up. I'll just talk through my slides. I think most of you folks know what child fatality review is. The definition we use is that it's when you have an engaged, multidisciplinary community. In Georgia, that happens at the local level, at the county level. And it also happens at the state level, where you come together, and at the county level, what your teams are doing is that they're telling children's story, one child at a time. You're trying to really figure out what the causal pathways were in that child's life that led them to their death. And what's important about that is it's not just looking at the day the child died and what happened. You know, at the scene of the motor vehicle crash, for example. It's what happened in that child's life that put them on that trajectory to where they ended up, you know, not being here with us. And it's trying to figure out how you can peel back all of those things and then figure out where as a community in the state you can intervene to make a difference on that path for other kids. When that's done well, it creates a nice set of data that then can be used at the state and the local level to sort of drive recommendations. And that's the core of CDR or CFR, is you're using your findings from these reviews that happen locally in a multidisciplinary setting to actually take action to prevent other deaths. And not just preventing other deaths, but keeping all kids safe and healthy. In 2016, we have child fatality review programs in every state. That's the good news. The bad news is they really vary across the country. There's real discrepancy in the quality of the review programs and how they're funded, where they're located, et cetera, et cetera. But when we tally up the number of teens, we have about 1,250 review teams going on across the country. That's a lot of people meeting that are really all mostly volunteers. We also have teams in Guam now. We have a real interest in the South Pacific and forming teams all throughout the South Pacific, which is really pretty remarkable since they're such tiny places. The Department of Defense requires reviews of children that were known or suspected to have died from abuse and neglect. And we also have a lot of reviews now occurring on Indian tribes throughout the U.S. This is my favorite slide, so if it doesn't come back, I'll put it back up later. It's a little girl eating a peach.
And Terry, we will post, we'll
it's
post
all right.
These.
I'm not, I'm used to this.
The force is with us.
Your program in Georgia, I like to think of as pretty peachy. Okay. Sorry, you guys probably had a simple metaphor that's so overused, right? But you really are a pretty peachy model because you really do model your program after what we think the National Center is the best practice. And that some of those elements are is that you have local review committees that are required in every county. That's pretty remarkable that you're able to pull that off. Wherever we are around the country, when we're talking about teams, and I'm in a state that might have, 10 regional teams and they're complaining about getting that work done, I go, have you thought about what happens in Georgia? Do you know how many teams that they, how much work they have being done at their local levels and they manage to get it done? But part of that is because you also have strong support out of the office of the GBI that gives real hands-on support to your local teams. And I think tomorrow they're launching a big road trip to do their training around the state. That's a real element of success for you, for your state. And I don't think, we always tell people, you can have a really strong program, but that the heart of that is you've got to have state support to support the local teams. Because those teams aren't out there getting paid. The people that are attending those meetings aren't getting paid. They're there because, they want to be there, but they really do need that support and you provide it. The other thing is that in Georgia, you do a lot of reviews such that you almost always meet the Healthy People 2020 objectives. Those are the national standards for death reviews. There's two of them. One is that they want states to be reviewing 100% of all deaths due to external causes, which Georgia almost meets, and all deaths due to sudden and unexpected infant deaths, which Georgia does. And I think it's really been one of the reasons you've had some real success in identifying and launching your Safe Sleep Coalition and Initiative. The other piece about Georgia is you've been an early initiator of the National Case Review System. And your data goes into a national database that's now being used for national policy and practice. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. You also have strong state support. The fact that Judge Kell has been a member, what did you say today? You're a figurehead. You're more than a figurehead. The fact that you're able to pull a team together at the state level and have support and have a board that meets regularly and consistently is to me impressive. And the fact that you do have the board. I think there's a little something else under there. I don't know what it is. But finally, the last one is that I think you're really starting not just to work on action at the local level, but start thinking about how you can translate your findings that you collect at the local levels and try to do something with the state. You're also a member of the CDC's funded suicide and sudden death in the young case registry. So Georgia's one of 10 states now that are really, they've got funding from the CDC, they applied, you got funded, and your requirement is that you have to review every single sudden death in the young that occurs in Georgia. You're trying to collect biospecimens that can be sent into a DNA repository so that families have access to those samples in the future, so that medical examiners can get DNA diagnostic testing on them, and so that NIH researchers can ultimately in the future get funded by the NIH to do research on that DNA so that we can try to really understand, especially kids who die when we don't have answers, and we think some of those answers lie in their DNA. So kudos to Georgia for being part of that process. It's not an easy project to be a part of. It's a lot of work. Child death review, I mentioned, you know, it's all about meeting together, trying to figure out what's going on. And I think of it as a really simple process of information sharing at the review meeting. People come, they bring their records. Talking about the case itself starts out being hard, but it becomes kind of second nature to teams once they're up and running. But the really hard part then is how do you figure out what you're going to do as a team and as a state to figure out what to do to change things based on your findings. And that's where it gets really complicated. Why do we do it? We know that for every child that dies, and this is, I think, based on injury data. For every child that dies from an injury, there's 25 hospitalizations, 925 kids treated in an ER, and many, many more in doctor's offices. So for every child death that you review, what you're really doing is you're pinning your hopes on the fact that you're also trying to prevent a lot of injuries and illnesses and poor birth outcomes for babies. So just reviewing the deaths, it's way more than that. It's just the tip of the iceberg for you in your work. The elements of CDR, or CFR as you call it in Georgia, are it's got to be multidisciplinary. It's telling that story using multiple data sources. And the more data information you bring to the table, the better your reviews are going to be. We all know, and I think Georgia really models this, that it's not focused on trying to pin blame, and it's not trying to figure out which agency screwed up. It's really about figuring out what we can do to move forward to change our systems and implement prevention practices to keep kids safe. And it really is that tricky balance between the individual reviews and the individual stories and how you use all of that to create an accumulation of fatal and non-fatal data for your trends studies. And this is another way to look at it. When you do a review, and it usually leads to improved communication, oftentimes at a local level and oftentimes at a state level. When it's done well, and Georgia's a really good example of this, it leads to improved investigations. You guys have done enormous work in your state changing investigation practices, especially around sudden unexpected infant deaths. You're meeting national standards on that with the use of dolls for doll reenactments, et cetera. And then when it's done well, it can lead to significant improvements in agency practices. So when the reviews are done well, agencies oftentimes look inwards, they take the information, they go back, and they talk about what can our agencies have done differently that might have had an impact on this death. How could child welfare had changed the practice? How could public health have changed the practice? How could the medical examiners or the GBI office have done something differently that might have led to a better outcome? And when you're doing that, no agency's exempt from these kind of internal reviews. I want to encourage you. I think when CDR or CFR started, a lot of people thought this was about let's go get child protection. It was all about figuring out how those workers screwed up. Right? We really aren't that anymore. That was 20 years ago. We're really now about moving forward and thinking about comprehensive, overarching systems improvements. And then the last piece, the most important piece for me, is prevention. So CFR is really about creating the power to prevent deaths. I think in your report, is this the next slide? I'll talk about this in a minute. What I really want to encourage you to do is to think big. So you've got local teams that are making recommendations, and you want local action. You want those findings shared locally, and you want your local teams to take action. But you also want those findings to be brought up to your state fatality review board, and then you want that stuff to get out to your governor and your legislature. You want your agencies to start acting on things statewide. And I was here last year kind of pushing you towards that, saying that's really where, for me, for Georgia, that's where your next world is. To really take it to making serious systemic and substantial change at a state level based on your local reviews. At the national level, we're kind of taking this ourselves seriously at our center. We were refunded by the Maternal Child Health Bureau this year. They actually combined two resource centers into one. They took the Fetal and Infant Mortality Review Center and our former center into one. And our push now with our funding at the federal level is to practice what we preach at a national level, is to start taking state findings that come into the case reporting system and start advocating for national change in policy and practice. They've actually given us the red light, or the green light, to go ahead. Yeah, we thought it was the red light. They've given us the green light to start issuing policy briefs on our findings, which is pretty remarkable. And that's going to be the work of our National Advisory Board. We're going to start doing policy briefs on our findings with recommendations for practice at the national level. I'm really excited about it. We've already got partners that have started looking at the data. The Consumer Product Safety Commission, we met with them last week at their behest. They really want to start using child fatality review data to be more proactive about product failures. And getting teams to start thinking about a product failure is not just a toy that a child can choke on. A product failure can also be a crib full of junk, right? Toys that end up in the crib that are dangerous. They're thinking of things that are more than just failures that are inherent in the product themselves, but failures that are inherent in the way people use products. So we're pretty excited about that because they're going to start using the data for that. SAMHSA is sort of blown away at the suicide information that they can learn from child death reviews. A paper just got published this week on injury prevention using child death review data on suicide. SAMHSA has told us many times they don't have any other source of this kind of data that comes at them that can tell the stories on suicides like they get from child fatality reviews. They're going to do some work where they're going to ask their Garrett Lee Smith or their suicide prevention grantees in the state. Is Georgia one? Are you guys a Garrett Lee Smith grantee? They're going to start asking, requiring the grantees to start using child fatality review data in your assessments and start partnering and being members of the child fatality review teams in the states that are granted with these dollars. So there's some really exciting things happening with SAMHSA. The CDC already funds the SUID and the sudden death in the young case registry. So they're using all of that data to try to drive prevention strategies through those issues. Next week, we're meeting with Safe Kids. They want to focus their 2016 drowning prevention campaign on child death review findings. So we're coming together with them where they're going to start looking at the data from child death review to see if we can really pigeonhole where they want to focus their drowning campaign efforts. So we're pretty excited about that. And these are just other examples. I'm a member of the National Commission to Eliminate Child Fatalities. We're in the middle of doing our final set of recommendations. It's been a two-year journey. It has been really complicated and really difficult because we have found that it's really hard to figure out what actually works to prevent child fatalities. It's really, really hard. But they have been really proactive in trying to use the findings from death review teams because a lot of those findings from those reviews really tell the story. And I think there's going to be some pretty significant recommendations in there to really try to force federal support for more fatality reviews and stronger fatality review programs in the state. So we're pretty excited about that. So in Georgia, right, I don't want to spill your beans here, Monica. But I wanted to just, this was one piece that I took out of your report, which was 78% of the 503 deaths that we reviewed in 2014 were preventable. And the teams made 211 recommendations. So my question to you today is, so what are you gonna do with that at the state level? You know, the local teams, 211 recommendations, they're working on it. There's three pages of recommendations in the report that demonstrate what the local teams are doing. I would ask you, what are you gonna do at the state level about those 78%? Cases. Some of the actions you're already doing, Arlena helped me with this, is you passed Senate Bill 138 that at least allows agencies to share data across agencies so that you can get better data. That's huge. I think we're actually in our National Commission report, we're going to have a whole chapter on data sharing because every place we went around the country during our public hearings, everybody told us that the barriers to information sharing absolutely keep us from knowing what should be done to help keep kids alive. So I really applaud Georgia for passing Senate Bill 138. I also know that you guys have partnered with your Department of Public Health and Children's Services for your statewide Safe to Sleep campaign, which is a really big deal. You've got resources out there now. You guys are really doing some amazing stuff. You're getting ready to launch your hospital initiative, et cetera. I just think that's incredible. And I guess you're getting ready to launch some more safe sleep infant death investigations as you start your great journey road trip this week. And then you did the gun law. I don't know what data led to the gun laws being distributed, but something happened. So I think it's just really great that at a state level, you took local findings and you acted on them. My challenge to you is you can do more. And the other thing to you in terms of a challenge is I know after Malika presents, you're also going to hear from DFCS, or I don't know how you guys pronounce it. on their reviews. One of my challenges to you is to think about how the two processes, the CFR review process and the DFAC review process, can kind of blend your findings and think about what review findings and what recommendations cross over from those two worlds and how can you actually strengthen your recommendations and your ability to take action based on the fact that you have two review processes that are both operating in the state. So try to think of ways that you can sort of merge your findings and your outcomes from that to give you greater power. I think there's still some challenges. Certainly, and this is true all the way across the country, is that CFRs don't do a good enough job addressing disparities and inequalities in their deaths. When you look across the board, across the country, in almost every cause of death, there's disparities, with a few exceptions. But even those exceptions are kind of disparities if you think about it. So I would just really challenge you to start looking at where your disparities occur and why, and start thinking about whether you need to do some focused recommendations and focused prevention to really kind of minimize health disparities in your fatalities. Another challenge, and it's always going to be with us, is funding. I think you have a well-funded program, but I always feel you can do more, right? I always just say that because I think funding is really important. And that's especially true when you start looking at your recommendations. We hear it all the time across the country that, well, we got really good recommendations, but how the heck are we ever going to pay for this? That's actually a big fight that we're having on our commission right now. It actually made the press this week because we're having struggles with how much do you ask for? Because there'll never be enough for what you need to do to keep kids alive. But how well and where you get the political will within your state to fund what needs to be done to prevent deaths based on your findings. And part of that is your political support to implement your recommendations. But where do you find that? So the bottom line for me, and this is the last slide I have, is just to try to keep your eyes on the prize. And I really think you do that by working together. This panel that we're going to have up here today, I just think it's wonderful. You're one of the only states, in fact, I don't know of any other state, actually, that has an event like this, where you bring all your agency leaders, and you bring them together, and you talk about it, because what that is, it starts the conversation about working together on this. And I really applaud you for doing that. My call out to you is just keep your eyes on the prize, which is preventing deaths by working together. Thank you.
Does anybody have any questions at all before we move on?
And now we're going to do the statewide.
Unintentional deaths,
And for our unintentional deaths, it's actually a third of the deaths. And that's going to be your motor vehicle crashes, your asphyxia, and these are your non-infant asphyxia deaths. Fire, weapon, poison, all these are examples of unintentional deaths. Now, when we get into intentional deaths, that's going to be your homicides and your suicides. One thing I do want to point out here is that when you compare this to 2013 data, you still had, of course, sleep-related was still the highest, and the medical and motor vehicle were the leading causes. But we did have medical deaths. As far as medical, there were 80. And for motor vehicle crashes, it was 130. I'm sorry, for motor vehicle crashes, it was 97. So we did see a little swap there between those two. Every year, it doesn't change. We have far more males that die than our females. Males actually comprise about 64% of the total. Yes, and that's something, like I said, we see from year to year. Not sure why, but our males definitely die at a much higher rate than our females. Race and ethnicity. When we look at race and ethnicity, our African Americans account for a much, much higher number than when we compare them to our other races. For our African Americans, they actually accounted for 53%, which is over half. And every year we do see a much higher number with the African American population. And so that's something that we definitely need to look at addressing in Georgia. Okay, so looking at our leading three causes, as you can see, sleep-related infant, medical, and motor vehicle, I'm just gonna spend a little time on these three. So breaking out our sleep-related infant deaths, there were 96 suicide deaths. And so with our suicide deaths, those are the sleep-related deaths where there's not an actual cause. You can't identify a cause, but there are prominent risk factors. And those prominent risk factors are going to be bed sharing, prone sleep position, things of that nature. With our asphyxia deaths, there were 52. Those are going to be our overlay and our wedgie cases. Ooh, with our suicide medicals, that's a different category we actually came up with. These are medical cause and manner of death. But with those, we saw that there were sleep factors that may have exacerbated the medical condition. So we had eight of those. And then with our SIDS are gonna be our deaths where essentially we're looking at the autopsy, we're looking at the scene, and we're also looking at medical findings, and there's nothing at all that we can find that can point to what caused that death. When we look at demographics, there were 61% African-American, 31% white, 6% Hispanic, and 2% multi-race. Once again, of course, our males, we see a much higher number with our males. They accounted for 59%. When we look at age, of course, for infants, we're talking under one. And so with our infants, 66% were under 4 months. As far as sleep surface, 60% were in an adult bed, and 21% were in a crib or bassinet. Now, where I have when known, just to explain that, the reason I have 153 here is because there were 5 cases for which we didn't have that information. And so for sleep position, we had 153 cases where we had this information. And for these cases, 52 infants were on their back, and 61 were on their stomach. And then as far as the sleep surface, they were actually bed sharing 65%, so we see a lot of bed sharing in these cases. For our medical deaths, males accounted for 62%. Once again, we see a much higher number with our males. African Americans, yet again, 61% when you compare it to all other race categories. Looking at the cause of the death, cardiovascular, pneumonia, and asthma, and then also neurological and seizure. When we look at motor vehicle deaths, once again, males are comprising the highest amount. We look at 63%. With our African Americans, our whites, there were 41 whites, 33 African Americans, 4 Hispanics, and 1 other race. For age category, 15 to 17, they accounted for the highest rate. We look at 43%, almost half of all the reviewed deaths. And of course, there's no question as to why we see so much for 15 to 17. Get behind the wheel, there's a lot of distractions, texting, things like that. So that's why we see so many 15 and 17. When we look at the position of motor vehicle deaths, for our passengers, 44% were passengers. So that's 35 cases. With the pedestrian deaths, these are children outside of the vehicle. There were 23 of those. If we break that down by age category, 8 were 15 to 17, 7 were 1 to 4, and 8 were 5 to 14. Drivers. There was a total of 16 driver deaths. Of those, I think you would typically, of course, think you're going to have your older teens, 15 to 17, but there were 3 cases involving children 10 to 14, which, of course, we know they had no business buying a little bit. Yeah, 10 to 14. And I'm going to just close it out by saying that we really owe it to our children to make sure we do something about this. And I know a lot of times we think about something elaborate, you know, something really massive, you know, some kind of initiative that needs to be done. But honestly, it's something that each and every one of us can do. We can be on a daily basis, talking to our friends, talking to our families, talking to our coworkers. So it's important for each of us to try to make sure we do what we can to address these issues. Thank you.
I did, and I apologize for that. Yeah, I did want to say one thing right quick.
This is Judge Tank Hell. He is one of the co-chairs of the Child Fatality Review.
First of all, it's wonderful to be here again with you this year. Thank you, Polly, for inviting us. I greatly appreciate what Voices does for the state of Georgia and also what Georgia can means and will mean for children in our state. The data that you've just seen, I want to say I'd be remiss if I didn't say that I believe that the data that we are now collecting and sharing with you and with the state of Georgia is the best, most accurate, and most complete data that we've been able to share in all of the time that I've been associated with this panel. There are a number of people who are responsible for the fact that it is the most accurate and incredible data that we've ever had. And I will probably forget some of them, but I would start certainly with the staff of the Child Fatality Review Panel who have done a magnificent job, not only of assisting in the collection of this data as they have always done, but also in going to the root, which is the 159 local CFR panels that we have in the state, and training those folks not only about what the data is and how they ought to fill out those forms, but how much it means and why it's important to get that correct. And they've done a fantastic job of traveling the state and explaining to the folks out in the field who are the real investigators of these deaths why the data that they send to us is so important and what we do with it and why we will be using it in the future to help prevent child deaths. So I thank them very much for that. I also thank very much the Georgia Bureau of Investigation, because as many of you know, the administrative responsibilities for this panel were transferred to the GBI a couple of years ago. GBI has provided to us some amazing resources that we just simply didn't have at our disposal before. And I thank the director, while he's here, very much for every time that we said we needed something, he has said, we will provide that for you. It's not in his budget. It's not necessarily something that they had a line item for, but we have not been turned down for something that CFR really needed. I will also take the time, and I don't want to steal his thunder, but I will thank the drug dealers of the state of Georgia for providing most of that funding for us so that we could get safety for all of those proceeds so that we could have those funds available to us. But what I say is I believe now that we are on the right track with the data that we have to being able to make real and viable and important recommendations, which is one of the core responsibilities of the statewide Child Fatality Review Panel, so that we can continue and to do our job, which is why everybody else is in this room today, which is to prevent child deaths in the state of Georgia. So thank you for letting me fill in that little bit, and thank you all very much for being here, and I'll talk to you some more in just a minute. Thank you.
Okay, that's awesome. So to continue with our awesome presentation, Mr. Bobby Cable of DFCS is going to present the DFCS data, which I know you'll say this, but we can't say enough, is a subset of the whole statewide thing. So in the years past, there's been some confusion around that.
Thank you, Polly, and thank you to everyone who's here today. This is such an important subject, not necessarily a subject that any of us enjoys talking about, but certainly one that deserves our attention. And so thank you for being here. Wanted to tell you that after 2 p.m. today, actually it should be now, the DFACS Child Tally Report for the calendar year 2013 will be available online at our website at dhs.ga.gov/DFCS. And so I invite you to look at this in more detail if you would like. I'd also like to let you know that we have done a couple things this year that have, I think, improved the quality of the work that we've done in this regard. The first thing is that we decided we were going to engage Georgia State's Department of Public Health, or School of Public Health, to help us in providing expert assistance in analysis and in statistical processing of all the information that we collect. I think it also brings another level of objectivity that we can't bring because we are so close to the data, regardless of the fact that we actually have a team that does this as its job. That really helps us. Also, in the vein of improving objectivity, we have turned over the leadership of the calls regarding any fatality that involves DFACS to the Office of the Child Advocate. And I have to thank Ashley Wilcott and her staff for very ably handling those calls. It sounds like an easy thing to do to walk through that, but it is really difficult to be able to carefully walk through that without having people walk away feeling as though they've been accused. And sometimes somebody needs to be accused, but most of the time it is a situation where we're trying to understand very fine points of work that involve discretion that we have to have in the work that we do. So thank you very much to Ashley and her staff. One thing I would say in preface here is that the more I look at this data, and I've been doing this work for 27 years now, the more I look at child fatality data and the work that we do, the more I'm convinced that there are no quick fixes. There are no quick fixes to this work. And I'm not saying this in a self-serving way, but if it were effective to change the DFACS director every time you have a child dead, you would think that changing the director 9 times in the last 12 years would have accomplished something. But yet, here we are today talking about child deaths. And so thank you, and I invite you to join me in making this something that you take on personally, professionally, to help advance in the work that we do. I wanted to give you first a snapshot of calendar year 2014. You'll see that we have well over 100,000 reports to the division. That's about a 24% increase over what we saw last year. When we report this again next year, that will have a significant increase even above and beyond that. You'll also see that we're handling more family support cases. The family support cases, I think, have had a 27% increase over last year, an 11% increase in the number of investigations. Foster care has also increased by about 14%. And all those things are indicative to me that just the fact that we're involved doesn't necessarily mean that the outcome is going to change. So we have to look at the way that we're involved in order to be more effective in doing this work. This is a graphic that just illustrates what Polly said before I came up, that this is a subset of data. Traditionally, we have released this report separate and apart from the Child Fatality Review Report. After being asked numerous times if this was in addition to the Child Fatality Review work, I thought it was important that we join these efforts because this is actually a subset of the 1,515 children that died throughout the state. Also want to look here at the manner of death for children. Manner of death is primarily 52% from natural causes and from accidents. 14% of the deaths were from homicides. which is consistent with previous years. That's held relatively steady, which is a sad commentary in and of itself. Included in those homicides were four children who were in care, in care division. And let me give you a little more detail behind those. The first is one youth who was murdered, who was on the runaway. You may have heard of a stabbing death in Hurt Park, very close to 2 Peachtree where we work. That was a young man who had run from foster care and was living on the streets. We had 2 children who have allegedly died at the hands of their caretakers. Both of those received wide media attention. Both have foster parents who are actually in custody and awaiting trial for murder at this point in time. And then we also had another child who was killed accidentally. I think that was a gun accident that involved him and another child that was a little bit older, I think around a 12-year-old child that was involved there. Very sad, but good to understand. This graph is pretty simple. What we look at is, by and large, children who are very young. All of my experience, all of the literature that you'll read will tell you that children under 3 years of age are the ones that are more likely to die. And you can see from this graph that after you get to 3 years of age, this is a pretty flat line. Most of these are children, and I think that is about 56% of the 169 deaths at 2 years of age are younger. 53 of these were sleep-related. We saw that reflected in a larger number in an earlier slide. This is something that was brought to us as part of the work that Georgia State does. We started looking at, rather than absolute numbers, looking at this in terms of population. So what is the rate per 100,000 children? And that's the standard way of looking at the occurrence of deaths in a public health context. And so this gives you an idea of the areas of the state where the incidence of death is higher. And you can see from about Macon South that there is a much greater likelihood, and in many cases 50% or more greater likelihood that a child will die in DFCS custody. The interesting thing about this, and we have not been able to really determine what is at play here, this will be work that we'll do ongoing, but if you look at this, if you look at any child indicator in the state of Georgia, most of those will have negative indicators below the Macon County line. And so we're looking further at this with Georgia State. They will continue to work with us to better understand what this means. I think at the very least what it means is that we have to really consider redoubling efforts when we are concentrating staff that we get in addition to what we have now in order to try to impact this. I think it also speaks to what any of us who work in this area know, that when you get into southwest Georgia in particular, you have a dearth of resources. And the mental health resources is one example. The number of psychologists, psychiatrists, therapists in that area are much less than what you have in the metro area of New York. So something that we'll continue to look at very intently. We also looked at this to see where we are with children with DFCS prior history compared to the general population. So the way we look at this by law is looking back for 5 years. So if a family had contact with the Division of Family and Children's Services in the child welfare arena within the prior 5 years, we considered them in this count. Now, you will see from the 2-year-olds, you may have cases that occurred 5 years ago. The child that died was not even in the family at that point in time. So make sure to really consider what the dynamics are here and whether it's something that we actually can impact. I think we can. You'll see that during that time period, we had an excess of 676,000 children that we contacted in the division. 676,000. It's a lot. During this time, we had 169 children die, that is slightly less than 25 deaths per 100,000 children. The child fatality rate in 2014 statewide was 61 children per 100,000 children in Georgia. And being a social worker, as soon as I saw that, I wanted to jump to a conclusion. However, the people that work for me, that know statistics well, reminded me of my statistics work in college and something called the tyranny of small numbers. Rather than jump to an extrapolation that children that come into contact are, the feedbacks are safer than the general population, what it says to us is that we need to look more closely at that to make sure that we understand that. I don't think we can really make that kind of conclusion yet. I wanted to also talk to you a little bit about the evolution in my thinking about the way the things involved in child welfare. I think this may also reflect some thinking in the general public. And I want to propose to you in the end something a little bit different. So the general public, I think, and before I started working in child welfare, had a really linear view of things. So basically, you had a family with a presenting problem, you put in an intervention, and you come out with a safe child. An example of this would be an unsupervised child. We see this a whole lot. So you would think that this is a parent who probably needs some assistance in knowing how to parent, how to supervise. So you put parenting pet classes in place, and you would hope that that child would be safe. Unfortunately, what we find many times is that these are repeat offenders. You can do parenting classes, but something does not click with them. So the linear model is actually much, much too simple. The next is what I call a complexity model. So you have a presenting problem, an intervention, and then you can end up with either a safe child or an unsafe child. The next is what I call an extreme complexity model. And this is oftentimes what we see. Presenting problems in families usually are not one and done. It is multiple problems within the family. So you start looking at this and you think, well, you need an intervention for a problem. And so that can end up in a child that's safe. It can end up in a child that's safer than they were initially, or it can end up with an unsafe child still. An example of the complexity that we look at is a family that may have substance abuse, schizophrenia, and complete social isolation, no social supports. If we put in substance abuse treatment, mental health treatment, and link them to a church, for instance, does that end up in a safe child? We hope that it improves safety, but we can't predict that because there are variability in the efficacy of the interventions that we put in, as well as the capacity of the individuals to change. So what I would point you to is what I call a wicked problem model. And wicked problems, I didn't actually just pull this one out of the hat. Wicked problems are problems in social science that have been studied and studied and studied for many generations, yet still persist. Poverty is an example of a wicked problem. Child welfare and the death of children in child welfare systems is also a wicked problem. So, for instance, in this situation, so you've got the multiple problems, you'll have multiple interventions, but those interventions are not always delivered by DFACS. You have community partners that we have to work with. Then you have what I call confounding factors. There are all sorts of those that may jump up in there, and it really impacts whether the child is safe or not. In the example, continuing what I had earlier, you have substance abuse, schizophrenia, no social support. So we put in substance abuse treatment with a community service board. You have a mental health treatment, and you have to have a psychiatrist to administer the meds for a person with schizophrenia. We link them to a church, First Baptist, or whatever community steps in, and they're trying to provide them with church home, social support. Then you start looking at the confounding factors. Confounding factors such as The service providers are only open during working hours. No transportation to get to the service. Unstable employment on the part of the individual. And you start looking at this and you think, this really is acts on one another as well, because unstable employment can be acted on by the fact that you have a person who leaves work to go get a service because it's only available during working hours, then they lose their job as a result of that. Then you have something called that I call changing family composition. It's something we oftentimes see. We start assessing a family, and we have a family that has a composition of a mother and two children, for instance. Somewhere along the line, we end up with a boyfriend that enters the picture. And that completely changes the family dynamics. It's something that we have to go back and reassess again. I do all this just to indicate to you the complexity of the work that we do and what is going to be required in order for us to get on the right side of this issue. And I would say to you that that is going to really require a multidisciplinary effort. It's going to require a set of strategies that really target on specific problems and that multiple agencies work on together. The best example I can give you right now is the safe sleep work that we've done. We are working on that in every single agency that I can think of. The Department of Early Care and Learning was not up there when we talked about the Safe Sleep campaign, but they actually were one of the forerunners in implementing changes to rules in child care facilities to prevent safe sleep deaths. And so it's a great example of where we need to get. So in summary, we had children of 2 years of age or younger that accounted for about 56% of 169 deaths. 53 of those, again, were sleep-related. Children in South Georgia are at least at a 50% higher risk than north of that line. And again, we had 4 homicides, which is something that we are all very concerned about. 58% of the deaths were children with caregivers with an alleged history of substance abuse. I think Director Keenan will tell you that this is something that we're tracking down in safe sleep deaths. In many of these cases, is we are trying to tease out what are the factors in safe sleep deaths. And oftentimes we run into a substance abuse issue, be it an illegal substance, alcohol, or prescription drugs that make the parent unable to wake up as they would normally and oftentimes roll over on the child. 38% of the children who died had caregivers who had been convicted of crimes. I say that not to say that I've come to any conclusion on that, but to say this is another thing that we need to look at to determine how we can work with those who are incarcerated to help them come out and be better parents. What will it take to improve these? Long-term, multidisciplinary efforts with our communities. The entire effort can fail if we don't have the buy-in of our local communities. We also have to integrate trauma-informed practices into the work that we do as a division, but also the work that gets done in other parts of state government. We also need our providers to be providing trauma-informed care. And I have to say, in many respects, providers are ahead of us on this. We also need ongoing community engagement, consultation, and involvement. We are doing that. We are traveling around the state trying to put these issues out there, get the feedback from communities so that we can work with them on this. We don't need to work on their behalf. We need to work with them. We also are trying to strengthen Georgia's response to child abuse and neglect through adoption of a research-based practice model known as solution-based casework. That is a 28-month effort. So if you see the long-term up at the top, I will underscore for you, this is not something that can be done in short order. It takes time to implement the changes that will make a lasting difference. It will take us 28 months to implement the practice model beginning this July in Fulton and DeKalb counties. And I would note for you that all the things that we're doing here are really elements of what we're calling the blueprint for change. We've got to have enough staff to do the work. We have to have the kind of practice model training that we will allow us to improve the work that we do. then we have to have engaged communities. We also have to have a curtailment of the number of staff who leave our workplace. We have 36% turnover in the key position in child welfare, and that is our frontline case manager. Regardless how many staff we have, if we don't get control of 36% turnover, the issues that we're talking about right now will continue on and on. And so I'm very pleased that the governor and the legislature have seen fit to assist us in all these areas, and I hope you'll join me also in fighting these issues where you live and where you are. Thank you.
I'm going to invite our panelists to come on up and grab a chair. So, you guys pulling up your question cards? Yes, question cards.
Over here, please.
Don't forget, there's a quiz. Who's that? Studying your addiction. All right, so I think what we can do, there should be why don't we go ahead, Judge Buck, why don't we just start with you and talk about your role in the child fatality review. 3 to 5 minutes of your the most important salient points you want to make, and then we'll move on down the chain.
Walker. I'm Dugal Court Judge in Douglas County, and I have the pleasure of serving as Vice Chair of the Child Fatality Review Panel. The Juvenile Court serves on both as a representative on both our local committees for child abuse protocol as well as on the Child Fatality Review. Because judges are conveners, and we have the ability to bring stakeholders together and to get people to work together. Among this particular group, I have the unique name of being called the enforcer. Yeah. My job is when committees are not working well, to make those phone calls to the committees and say, why haven't you opened up this file? Why haven't you done this review? And of course, there's a lot of pushback when someone is doing the role of the enforcer. But I follow up with that, well, if you don't want to hear it from me, I would be happy to have the director of the GPI give you a call. The end result is, after spending 2 years being the enforcer, we do have much better data, and we do have much better compliance. And it's because everyone now understands that they have a role. Now, I can assure you that there have been a number of people who have been unhappy with that, but the end result is that we point them to the statute, we point them to the fact that we are doing collaborative work, and that we are working to prevent deaths. And why wouldn't someone want to do their work if they thought they were making things safer for our children? So judges play a very important role in being that convener.
As DFCS director, my role with Child Fatality Review is to sit on the statewide panel. I have performed that function for the last 20 months as director, but prior to that, when I worked with DFCS before, between 2006 and 2010, I was the DFCS director's representative to Child Fatality Review. I have to tell you that I've been very pleased by the difference that I've seen over the last 20 months. When I went before, I was there, tried to provide input as best I could, but oftentimes I felt as if we were admiring the problem but not really doing a whole lot about it. And since the 20 months that I've been back, I have seen more action, more movement to do positive things to try to impact the numbers than I have seen in the prior 6-8 years. So I'm very pleased to be a part of the group, and I think they're doing wonderful work.
And I'm Dr. Brenda Fitzgerald, and I'm the commissioner of the Department of Public Health. And I think what I'd like to use my time to talk about is the collaborative effort that has happened with every single person here and Commissioner Jacobs that's in the audience. We decided that not only this year, but last year, safe sleep was a huge problem for us. And then we decided that just a campaign to try to increase awareness was not enough, and we were going to do more. So it has, in all the agencies, change has occurred. Certainly, you know that we have investigation and training at GBI, which is enormously important. Because one of the problems we talked about last time is that when we look at these episodes, because the majority of them are sleeping with co-sleeping, meaning the child is in the same surface with an adult. And we need to know if there's going to be there. Drugs involved, if there's alcohol involved, and GBI has really ramped up, and I will talk about it, I'll let you talk about it, ramped up their efforts on that front. One of the things we think also is that we need to begin at the beginning, and one of the things that's public health's particular sweet spot is our relationship with the hospitals. We have already had our initial approach to the hospitals with every single birthing hospital, we got a tremendous response. Over 75% of the hospitals were there at that initial meeting when we were talking about the hospital response. And we will, of course, reach out to those others that weren't able to attend at that first meeting. That, what will happen, and this will be launched in this spring, is that we have acquired monies so that we can make sure that, one, hospitals are trained, hospitals give the information, and parents leave the hospital with reminders of what you need to do to have safe sleep. And safe sleep, of course, is ABC, alone, on your back, and in a crib. And the monies involved, you saw that this side up. Our sleep gowns I have on one side, this side up, and on the back, please turn me over. As soon as the hospitals are prepared, as soon as the policies are changed in the hospital, because one of the things that we've noticed is that hospitals themselves were not placing the babies on their backs to sleep. And of course, when parents saw this, that was a problem. So part of this initial work is to get hospital policies in place. And then once the hospital policies in place, we again have monies for sleep gowns, for books that parents can take home, and for cribs, travel cribs that parents can take home. This work will be announced in the spring, and at that time we hope to have several hospitals trained. There are one or two that have already completed everything, and so I think that from my point of view, having that public-private partnership is how you do it. Bobby's folks know, Amy's folks know, the people you talk to know, the GBI knows. We want to make sure the entire community knows and reinforces that message every single time.
Thank you very much. My name is Tane Shell, and I'm a Superior Court judge in Cobb County, and I chair the State Child Fatality Review Panel. The responsibility of the State Child Fatality Review Panel, of course, is to oversee the 159 Child Fatality Review Panels in the counties and the local entities that are actually conducting the reviews, the direct reviews of the cases as soon as they arise within the jurisdiction, to make sure that they're doing that, to follow up with them, but also to emphasize, as I said a few minutes ago, how important it is that they correctly report each of those deaths, categorize them, and send to the state the data that is reflected to tell us everything essentially that we can learn about that death. Because if the belief is, and the belief in the legislation is, that if we have accurate information about how these deaths are occurring in our state, then obviously the other responsibility, or one of the other main responsibilities of our panel, is to make recommendations, to develop programs, to develop legislation, to propose those types of things in order to prevent those types of deaths in the state of Georgia. And so we have emphasized over the past several years the importance of collecting the appropriate data so that we can do exactly that. The second prong of that is, as I said a few minutes ago, the responsibility for educating the people in the field who are actually conducting the investigations, I'm educating the public as to how to assist in the prevention of these types of death on a statewide basis, to raise public awareness of the types of preventable deaths that are occurring in Georgia and the prevalence of those types of preventable deaths, and then also to assist agencies and law enforcement and the other folks who are out in the field in any way that we can in assisting in the, either the investigation of those deaths or in educating their people as to how to recognize and identify these types of deaths that occur. And so there's been a great bit of emphasis on that. Hopefully in a few minutes when we talk about some of the other things that the agencies are doing, I'll be able to tell you some of the things that we are trying to do to especially to identify those particular categories of preventable deaths that we think we can have a real impact on in the short term and then also in the long term. And so you are the folks out there who are the most helpful in that and spreading the word and raising public awareness. And we thank you very much for all that you do. I would also ask you to please take the opportunity to take this executive summary that we've given you of our data and also to go online and look at the more in-depth copy of that. We tried not to hand out as many paper copies of those as we have in past years in order to save the resources on that, but it's all available to you immediately online, and there's some incredible data in there for you. Thank you very much.
I'm Vernon Keenan, the director of the Georgia Bureau of Investigation, and the DBI provides the staff that supports the Child Fatality Review Panel in its work. But in addition, the DBI has other areas of responsibility in the child death area. For instance, the number one priority for our agency is the investigation of crimes against children. So many of these child deaths are investigated by GBI. We have the data, we have the investigative files, which we're then able to provide to the Child Fatality Review Panel. Additionally, the GBI has medical examiner responsibilities, and we do autopsies for 153 of the 159 counties. And in the year we're talking about, 2014, the GBI medical examiners did 319 autopsies of children. So we have a tremendous amount of data that relates to the death investigation process, which is also can be brought to bear for the work of the Child Fatality Review Panel. Now, looking at what we're doing in the prevention area, we're looking at 158 sleep-related deaths for 2014, but we actually started our program based on the 2013 child sleep death-related issues. There were 139 children died. So we looked at that. That's being the number one killer of infant children. So what are we going to do about it? We're going to start a prevention campaign. So collectively, all of the agencies up here work together to put together a training video entitled "Keep Saving Georgia's Children, a Guide to Safe Sleeping Practices." And this video is, as Judge Kale mentioned, was paid for by drug dealers in Georgia who had their assets seized by the court and put in to handle issues like this. This training video is available to each and every one who has contact or responsibility for children to educate them on safe sleep practices and the dangers of unsafe sleep practices. So, and we have copies here available for you. Please take them, use them, distribute them, use them to train however you feel, whatever you deem appropriate. All of our agencies up here have links to the video on their website, so we're getting the word out. Governor Deal and First Lady did a public awareness spot for the introduction to this video. Governor and First Lady have been very engaged in this ongoing project, and this is one of their priorities, is protecting children. In October, the agencies up here collectively hosted a training event at the Georgia Public Safety Training Center, where we trained over 400 persons who have responsibilities of the death investigation process when there is a child death. And we trained them on how to properly investigate unsafe sleep deaths so that we can get the most accurate information available through the investigation process, but also begin the practice of holding persons accountable who have criminal negligence associated with the child death. someone who is using drugs, is intoxicated, rolls over, and causes a child to die, needs to be held criminally accountable. So we're educating law enforcement, coroners, medical examiners, defect workers on how to do these types of investigations. So where are we headed for 2016? Currently, we're in the process of developing an app for no matter what your phone or technology, an app which will allow a person who has responsibility for conducting these types of investigations to go to that app, and it will list the step-by-step processes to conduct the investigation at the level we want this done. Something that new world using technology. That is ongoing. But also continuing our training of investigators, coroners, defect workers, anyone who's involved in this process, of putting uniform practices for doing these investigations. We got a lot going on. GBI prides itself on not talking about things, but seeing that we move things along and get things accomplished, and that's what we're doing here.
Thank you. My name is Ashley Wilcott. I'm the director of the Office of the Child Advocate, and I was appointed almost 2 years ago. And when I was first appointed, the CFR team was under OCA, and legislation had already been passed moving it to GBI. And all of the reasons you just heard from Director Keenan are the very reasons why the governor obviously had a very wise, good plan to move it to GBI, because it has been able to combine the law enforcement prosecution aspect, which in my mind was so missing from the CFR piece. So what does OCA do now? We serve on the panel, the CFR panel, and I'm honored and thrilled to serve on that with Chairman Kell. And I appreciate the opportunity to be here today with all of my colleagues and all of you here. There's a lot that I could say, but in order to try to look at it from one perspective as an oversight agency, OCA is in part, among other things, an oversight agency for any children who have been involved with the DFACS within the last 5 years. And so part of my perspective as an oversight agency is that this data gives us an opportunity to really drill down and look at the local communities on the local level. Why is that so important? Director Cagle already touched on it. You've heard information about it, because that's where the change is going to have to happen. Individuals can make the change. The data that's in the report, if you look at the report, the CFR report is very, very thorough and fabulous information. But a couple of pieces that I want to pull out and draw to your attention as an oversight agency that I think are important. Number one, of the 402 cases out of the total 503 that were reviewed by CFR in 2014, out of those 402, there was enough information provided for them to determine that they were definitely or possibly preventable. Let me say that again. Out of the 503, 402 were definitely or possibly preventable. That's a lot of cases. That's a lot of cases. That's a lot of children. Put cases aside. That's a lot of children. And so the goal is what? To prevent these deaths. I would submit to you as an oversight agency in the cases that we participate in conjunction with DFACS and collaboration with DFACS. My investigators are here today. The DFACS team is here today. They do incredible work, and they've led this work for a very long time. Those are individual children, individual cases, where I would submit that almost one person could have made a different choice, made a different decision, done something differently, and that death would not have occurred. So we've got to use the data that CFR has provided in this very thorough report to look at different communities to determine how can we look at the individual cases, how could we reach the community to engage the community, to get to the individuals, to educate the individuals in such a way that the individuals in that community can hear that education. What are some examples? Well, there are a lot of children who drown in the state of Georgia. That was what, the number two cause? Did I get that correct? I wrote it down. Number two cause of deaths, I believe, if you look at your report. Is that right? Number three? Number four. It's down there somewhere. It's high enough that it's disturbing to me. Let me just rephrase. I'm not going to misquote any data. But my point is, if you look throughout the state of Georgia, there are different environments, obviously, in which it happens. So you have the lake environments, you have the pool environments. And so while you want to educate everyone about supervising your children in water, period, you also have different ways that you have to approach it and how you have to actually educate the individual supervising, or in some cases not supervising, their children. Why are they not supervising their children? They're not swimming in the lake, they're playing on the edge of the lake. This is a real case, right? Oh, they're 4, 6, and 10. They always play on the edge of the lake. They're fine. I can see them from the window. Oh, yeah, I have to go to the bathroom sometimes. I went to the bathroom, and guess what? One of them wasn't fine. Because while they know not to swim in the lake, what did they do? They fell in the lake. So there's a lot of education around that. A pool is a different situation. You're going to supervise your child in terms of if it's properly gated, locked up, and somehow secured. It doesn't mean your child can't get in there, and it doesn't mean that they don't need to be supervised. It may be a different type of supervision. You still have to see them in the pool. So you have to figure out the best way to engage each local community, each county, because it's all different kinds of issues, people, environments, and types of education necessary. So we need to really focus on the individual needs. The other piece that I would note, 99 maltreatment deaths out of the 503. What does that mean? That there was some type of abuse, neglect, or poor supervision. So don't misunderstand me, I'm not speaking about Director Cagle's subset. So I don't want anyone to misinterpret the data that I'm quoting. But of these 99 deaths with poor supervision, abuse, or neglect, 47 were 1 to 4 years old, 30 were less than 12 months. That mirrors the data that Director Cagle already said, that the majority of the deaths, or a lot of the kids that die, are young, right? So as an oversight agency, what does that mean to me? Why is that important to me? Because as an oversight agency, we need to make sure there's early effective intervention. By that, people need to be educated to actually report abuse, report situations where they're concerned about the safety of the child. Number two, we've got to make certain that whatever the department is doing is sufficient to quickly assess the risk and ensure that the children are protected, right? They have to be able to do that effectively. And number three, we need to make sure that whatever services are to be provided, that are assessed and need to be provided, are actually available in the community and are being provided, and what's the missing piece, are effective. So that a parent isn't going to parenting classes every 6 months over and over again, but they're actually effective for that particular parent, for that particular parent to understand. The last thing that I just want to mention is OCA has some proposed legislation. It's a direct result of CFR's work, and I'll give you an example of a case. And this was actually a case that was moderated on a call, and there was a mother, and she was driving, and she had her children in the car, and she was pulled over. And that was the second time. The first time, she wasn't pulled over. The police approached her because she was asleep at the wheel, and the children were in the car. There was a second occasion. Right? Second occasion, she was pulled over. She was incapacitated, driving, children in the car. Now, law enforcement took appropriate actions. I'm not suggesting anyone acted inappropriately, right? But what happens? They get out of jail. Got out of jail. Next week, she rolled over on her baby in her bed. And the baby died. So, one of the things that OCA is working on in this legislative session, and we recognize there was a little bit of hold, I think inadvertent, but that child endangerment is not part of our mandated reporter law. So that there's no mandated reporter requirement if someone's driving intoxicated and has a child in the car, or if someone has a meth lab, and there's no mandated reporter requirement. And so we are working on legislation to change that, to add that, so that there's a mandated reporter in that situation. So I'd also encourage you to look at all of this data and information with an eye towards what's missing in our legislation, what perhaps could be changed or added. And I'm not suggesting it's time to run to the Capitol and tell someone we need this. I'm suggesting it's time for all of us to have a conversation as partners around those issues to figure out, is it appropriate, and if so, will it help prevent children's deaths and protect children?
Good afternoon, I'm Harris Black, but I'm Director of the Governor's Office of Highway Safety. And I want to say, first of all, thank you. Thank you for what you do for children. God bless you for what you do. You know, these little folks can't fend for themselves, and what you do is so important, and I want to thank you for that. I got some good news and some bad news. The bad news is we just came off the worst year in traffic fatalities in 10 years. We had a 17% increase in traffic fatalities, and it was awful. And the The good news is that in the under 17 group, we didn't see a significant increase. That's most of them were 17 and older. We did see a slight uptick in 16 and 17 year olds in terms of traffic fatalities. We actually saw these are all very preliminary numbers right now. We saw a slight decrease in the number of children involved in as passengers in cars, but we saw a slight increase in the number of pedestrian situations. We have a lot of places in this area, and you know where they are, where traveling on foot is the way this family travels until they get to a BART bus. And, you know, the thing that just drives me crazy is that so many of our pedestrian fatalities have happened within 150 feet of a BART bus stop. It's just terrible. We are doing all we can. We work with our partners at Department of Public Health and trying to make sure we have child passenger safety seats wherever we can. The bad news is I just got notice yesterday that we're not going to have as much money coming from Washington for the, sorry to tell you all that right now. And we're gonna find ways to do it. If I have to go knock on doors, I'm gonna do it. We're gonna make sure we put babies in the right seats, young children under the age of 8. And I want to tell you, if you've never been to a child passenger safety seat event, you need to go, because there's nothing more wonderful than seeing the face of a child who's in the right seat, fits right, you put them in that car, and they're happy, and boy, that smile just, it'll make your day. The other thing that's really good, we looked at some of the crash data from last year, and we saw a lot of situations where there were rollover crashes, sometimes injuring or even killing people within that car, but the child who was in that child passenger safety seat survived. And that's and I don't think they work. They do work. And you know, anybody, you know, there are people in this world who have some mentality that I'm gonna reward you, you know, if you be a good boy, I'll let you stand in the car. I mean, there are people who do this stuff. And you wanna go, what in the world are you thinking? And we see it all the time. We've worked also with our friends at DCAL and other places and other groups on hypothermia. And folks, up to last week, I thought hypothermia was a summer phenomenon. And I don't know whether many of you saw, but in Northwest Georgia, we had a situation that somebody left a child in the car and left the heat on. Thank God I'm not on that jury. It makes me so mad I could just spit. I'm gonna tell you, we're doing everything we can to educate folks, and and sometimes you just can't fix stupid. I see folks with kids in car seats and things, and the wrong way, and some of them don't have in seats, have four children buckled in one belt. It drives you nuts. We're going to do everything we can, though. We'll clean the slate for 16, and we want to have a better year. We believe this will be that year. And it is our pleasure to be here. And again, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for what you do every day for our children.
Thank you so much, all of you. We have a handful of questions here, so I'm too short for this one. To watch your fumble. I'm just going to start asking questions of the panel, and some of these are focused for certain panel members, but as I read them, you all, it sounds like they can be answered by multiple folks. So, let's see. I'm going to start with this one from Carl Lehman, Child Time. All right, Carl. Are all coroners created equal? Is there a consistent examination practice across the state?
Okay, let's take that one. So all coroners are not created equal, and we spend a lot of time, DBI does, training coroners on how to properly investigate cases, including child fatality cases. The consistency comes when the child reaches the DVI medical examiner's office, because they are the professionals, and they can handle it. The child has to get there, and we need the child to come there with the proper investigation having been done at the scene. If the coroner's not going to do it correctly, then we're educating law enforcement to step in and do it and get us the information that we need.
I'll give a little bit of credit where credit is due. Our panel member, E.K. May, who's one of our coroners, has been very helpful to us in getting the coroners more interested in attending our training sessions for child fatality review and becoming more aware of some of these issues like sleep infant-related deaths and some of the other issues that they'll confront as coroners over the past couple of years in particular. And we've had a much larger number of coroners come and be trained in those courses, but there are a lot more. I mean, we have 159 different jurisdictions, most of whom have coroners and not medical examiners in those jurisdictions, and we need more of them, and we need them better trained, I think, than they are right now. And that's not a slam on them. Most of their backgrounds, many of their backgrounds, just have not included the kind of training that would be necessary to spot some of these issues that repeat themselves time and time again. And some of these issues are subtle. You know, some of these maltreatment-related issues are very subtle in death cases, and sleep-related deaths and all of those things. And it does take specialized training, and we just need to make them aware that they need that training and get it and make it as available to them.
Thank you. Okay, so here's another one from, I have so many now, so good, you guys do a good job. Okay. This one is from Joe Sarah with the Georgia Advocacy Office. Where are you, Joe?
Over there.
Okay. He has multiple question marks.
I think I made it much more difficult than it needed to be.
I think your handwriting doesn't.
I know, it's like hieroglyphics. If you need me to break
do
it down,
you want to just ask a question?
Yes. Okay. So this is open to anyone, and it's very possible that you might not have this information readily available. But of those children who pass away due to natural causes, the first question would be: How is natural causes defined? Within that population, do any of those young people experience a developmental disability, and are the deaths a result of the fatal four that are most common amongst people that experience developmental disabilities?
Well done.
I think that was so much better than what I wrote on that card.
I can answer part of that.
Okay, thank you.
Child fatality review, if you look in the back of the child fatality review panel report, you'll actually see some identification of terms in one of the glossaries that's in the back that will help with how we identify for us what are the reviewable deaths according to the statute.
Right.
Many of the deaths that are simply deaths due to natural causes are not necessarily reviewable deaths for us and won't end up in these statistics. You'll see some that are classified as medical related deaths, and those are not normally deaths that are due to necessarily natural causes. They're more either some other medical complication that arose or something that arose in the treatment of that particular child that led to a death that makes it reviewable. And so from the child fatality review panel standpoint, that's how we identify those. We do go a lot based on what is reported to us either from the medical examiner or the coroner as to whether in fact the cause of death is reported is a medical related cause or is a natural cause or something, and that does help make a determination as to whether it's even a death that's reviewable and therefore reportable to us as the state panel from those local panels.
Okay.
I don't
Thank
know if that helps, but that's
that does,
part
that
of
does. Thank you much.
Okay. There's another one from Vanessa. Vanessa Ray.
Here.
Is there a statewide campaign to advertise ABC, like a campaign on AIDS?
Yeah.
Yes, I.e. malls, billboards, blah, 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 blah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, there is. And again, part of our, we have had a poster campaign last year that was very pervasive, but it didn't reach enough people. So again, we thought the best way to handle it, to get to get the most attention is when we have our hospital portion firmly in place. At that time, there will be a big press release, and the First Lady will be there, all of us will be there, the hospitals that are participating will be there, and we'll talk about it, the ABC, and hopefully at that time, again, the reporters can follow up to those hospitals that are putting it in place, because there's nothing more like a good baby for a good campaign.
One of the things that we have in each community is the Family Connections Collaborative. And we really need to house our prevention work there. And this is a great place for us to look to our local communities to implement ABCs. I have committed to assisting public health with getting this information out to juvenile court judges, but also to working with our local hospitals and make sure we're all on board so that our parents are receiving that same information. It's been really tragic in my community. We have two sleep-ready deaths in a small community of 120,000 in a week's time.
I will also say that one of the things, and I appreciate the question because it gives me an opportunity to talk about this, because you're the stakeholders and folks out there who can help us in continuing to promote this. One of the things that we're doing from the CFR during this legislative session is we have drafted a resolution that we hope to have passed in both the House and the Senate that relates directly to safe sleep-related practices and the importance of that, and emphasizes the number of sleep-related deaths that we've had here in Georgia, and quite frankly, understand this is a national trend, not just a Georgia trend. I'm sure all of you are aware of that, but sleep-related deaths, to try to highlight that and get more public awareness out there. And so what we intend to do is ask the Senate and the House of Representatives to pass these resolutions. And again, we've had great input from the governor and the First Lady, and we're hoping to make this essentially something that will help us kick off a public awareness campaign for our legislators, but also for the public at large about the importance of these safe sleep-related practices. And in addition, as Director Keenan said, there is also this public service announcement that has been done by the governor and the First Lady that relates to safe sleep practices that is very good. I hope you'll all take a chance and an opportunity to look at that and distribute it as widely as you can, because again, that is part of our ongoing public awareness campaign that we want to have to raise awareness of this particular issue, because quite frankly, we believe, I personally believe, speaking just for Tank Bell, that this is probably the one area of preventable child deaths that we can have the most impact on in the shortest amount of time if we concentrate the resources to raise public awareness about this issue and change some of the ongoing either stigmas or practices that people have that are kind of embedded in them from generation to generation about how children ought to sleep and how good it is for them to sleep in the bed with you and those sorts of things. And I'll give a shout out to Lisa Dawson, who helped us draft very much of the language for the resolution, and I appreciate her very much doing that with the Department of Public Health. Thank you.
Again, I think that if this is going to be successful, we have to have this message, the same message coming from various sources for a long period of time, and repeat it all.
Thank you.
Yeah, there's some stuff on the table up there too, in case you need to share the message. If you put together some good help from the CFR panel. Okay, I don't know who this is from. And it says it's for Director Keenan, but I think it's probably broader than that, is my guess, just looking at it. The CFR panel recommends every caregiver be drug screened following a child's death. The question is by whom and how? Law enforcement, DFACS, through something I can't read. Does GBI crime lab accept urine samples or just blood? What is the testing turnaround time, et cetera.
I'll take the first part of that, and then I'll let Director Keenan address the law enforcement aspect of that. From a CFR standpoint, I'd say that's an aspirational goal that we'd like to have, because legislatively and constitutionally right now, we don't have the ability to make that happen. Now, there is an opportunity or an ability to have that happen for caregivers of children who are in state control and care. We do have the ability to make that happen in those cases, and we're working with Director Cagle and the agencies that are affected by that in order to try to make that happen. From the standpoint of the ability to have that happen in every case for infant sleep-related deaths, we don't yet have that, but we are working toward trying to see if there are ways that we can get the authority to at least make a determination as to whether or not there are potentially drugs or alcohol involved in those.
Before we can draw blood from a person to analyze for drugs or alcohol, we have to have probable cause. And you develop probable cause through the investigation process. That's why when we talk about uniform processes for doing the death investigation scene work, that's the purpose. If sufficient information is developed during that scene investigation, which will give probable cause that caregiver, parent, or whatever, was under the influence of alcohol and drugs, then we can get a warrant, draw blood. The first step that we overcome was educating law enforcement, coroners, other people involved in this, that the tendency is to reach out and want to support the caregiver. We're so sorry that your infant died, and we feel just as bad as you do. And that's the sympathy factor kicks in, when in fact, we have an obligation to do a thorough investigation and then see that there's accountability established if that is appropriate. That's where all the training is ongoing about conducting proper death scene investigation.
There's another aspect to that too, that this year there was it's called neonatal abstinence syndrome. It means when a child is born in the hospital and it is obvious that that child of having drug withdrawal, that is now a reportable disease in Georgia, under Georgia law. So we are hoping that certainly if you have that situation, that will give us another avenue that we can have very strong interactions so that hopefully we can prevent some sort of death. Because obviously if a child is having neonatal abstinence syndrome, that means that child's mother has certainly taken drugs during the pregnancy, and we think there's a higher chance that that child will have drugs after the pregnancy.
DFACS also has capability to have drug screens performed in the communities. We have contracts with community providers all around the state, do a lot of drug screening. And in particular, if you have a case where a child dies and there's another child remaining in the home, we have a interest under law to assure that there's no remaining danger to the living child. And so we would work with law enforcement and also with the juvenile courts to obtain those specimens if we see a need for that.
One of the things that we really want to encourage law enforcement to do is to ask. We have learned that a lot of times when we ask parents to do things for purposes of a rule out, they will cooperate. And it's very important for us to be able to know to what extent we're dealing with substance abuse issues. In the juvenile court, we get the fallout from the death because we end up with jurisdiction over the siblings. And what we're finding out is when we actually get to do the drug testing, we have very serious, acute, long-term substance abuse issues.
So I'm just going to feedback a question onto that sent up here by Ron Scroggie back here in the corner. I was just wondering, how can we work collaboratively? So I'm just going to read that. It says, it seems for many years that substance abuse is often a factor in many categories. So how can we work collaboratively something to impact this issue? Ron's handwriting is right there with Joe's.
I think that we worked out a really good protocol with the Division of Family and Children's Services because we're doing family preservation cases. They're petitioning substance abuse cases without doing removal. And then we were using the opportunity of the courts to insist upon substance abuse treatment. And we also have funding for family treatment courts. And that is in the dependency realm where we actually do a drug court for parents who have substance abuse issues. We make it priority for women who are pregnant. We make it a priority when children are under five. because we know the death rate is so much greater for those children. And there will be legislation introduced to make the family treatment work part of the accountability court's counsel so that that work can go forward.
I think this is more. Okay. So two things that I just wanted to add. One is the proposed legislation I was just discussing. One of the benefits of child endangerment is added is that then DFACS has an opportunity after receiving a report to actually intervene early and address substance abuse issues early, which can prevent death of children. And so I've really seen a movement towards a lot of interagency cooperation, but really an approach of substance abuse does underlie so many of the deaths in so many different ways. And so we have to take an opportunity to look at every potential lost opportunity or loophole to find a way to close those and take the advantage of getting early intervention. So that's one way that that can happen. The other piece of that is, Judge Walker said something that triggered a thought in the courts that I now can't recall, but the substance abuse piece and reporting of it and educating family, because OCA does receive calls from family members who have concerns about a parent who has substance abuse issues, but they feel guilty for reporting, they want to think positively, they are enabling, they don't think that that person's ever going to neglect their child because of substance abuse, much less kill their child because of substance abuse issues, right? So there's denial, there's enabling, there's protectiveness, there are all of those things. And so I think as a community, as a larger community, we have to continue to educate that there's no stigma in reporting and trying to get help and reaching out when it is your brother, your sister, your child that has substance abuse issues. It is what it is, but they need help at early intervention.
You know, I think one of the things that we have worked on, again, with the Office of the Child Advocate that is very closely allied with this is the updating and adherence to the child abuse protocols required in law. And Jody Spiegel is
right there
waving. She has taken this on as a project that we could not have done without her help. And we found that we had protocols that were 10, 15 years out of date, had not been revisited. And as you can imagine, in many of those cases, the child abuse protocol committees had not been meeting in those local jurisdictions. So that is one of the key things that we've been working on, and so I think is so very helpful. Because as we look at the work we have to do, and I think you can see from my presentation, I'm advocating for more multidisciplinary interagency type initiatives because DFACS can't do it all. We don't have all of the expertise we need. Those multidisciplinary teams get us closer to that.
Can you stop there, Paul? That was perfect.
I know, just did. No, sorry. I still have 11 minutes. So I'm going to torture you for the last 11 minutes. And actually, I'm going to torture Commissioner Jacobs, who's out in the audience, too. So just get ready, because you can't come as a commissioner and I have to say something. I don't know where my badge is. All right, this one is from Regina Folks. Where are you, Regina? She's right there. Okay. And I'm assuming, and this is my own dad, I'm assuming ECE is early childhood education. Yeah. There's a lot of acronyms in my world, and I just want to be sure I'm in the right one. ECE directors work diligently with DECAL by going beyond established policies to prevent SIDS. What additional preventable methods can providers use to support zero to lower deaths in ECE programs? And then also, how many child deaths occurred in licensed centers? I don't know if you have a...
I do have that data. We talked about that earlier, and I just have for the past 2 years. So
you guys all hear Commissioner Jacobs?
I'm sorry, we reported on the federal fiscal year, so that's what we had handy before we came here this afternoon. But for the previous federal fiscal year, we had one death in a licensed childcare facility. And that was medically related. We do see a few more deaths in unlicensed facilities, which obviously is an issue. And then in the year before that, which would have been federal year 14, we actually had three deaths in licensed childcare. And one of those was a suspected SIDS. The others were medical related, or one was a strangulation.
Did I get your question there? Thank you. Thank you so much for being our voluntary, involuntary panel. My friend always said you were voluntold to do it. All right, this one, I'm going to take this question from our new executive director, Emily, who's right here. What are some of the opportunities to address child deaths through more attention to child health disparities in the state, as mentioned by Director Pick?
One of the things that I think is one of the more important things that we can do is that if you look at all, now not just the review, but if you look at all child deaths, for those 5,015 child deaths, 25% of them were for prematurity. And when you look at disparities, there really is a huge difference in the prematurity rate for African-American children and in the prematurity rate for white children. One of the things that has been most promising that we have seen, and we are hoping to increase that, is something called centering pregnancy. And that is a pregnancy where the Albany Health District, for example, their prematurity rate in the area around Albany was 17%, 17 out of 100,000 for African-American patients and 11 for white patients. And after a centering pregnancy that was very aggressive, it was lowered to like 6. So there are ways that we can approach and solve the problem of disparities, especially in medical problems.
You know, and I would expand on that just a little bit, because when we think of health disparities, we oftentimes think of medical things, but we also need to think in terms of disparities with regard to mental health and substance abuse. The issue that I pointed out earlier with the line that starts at Macon-Bibb and extends southward, I think is an example of disparity in availability of resources, if nothing else. When you get into southwest Georgia, it is very difficult to find providers that provide medical or mental health treatment, especially to those that are on Medicaid or that are served by Amerigroup under one of the managed care programs. We work with them very closely. Part of the problem is that you just have less providers in those areas. But there are also opportunities to look at the rates that are paid to providers in order to incentivize them being there. And much to their credit, Amerigroup is very much looking into that, has worked with me, as a matter of fact, on the spot in a meeting where a community member identified a deficit in South Georgia and had a provider covering that deficit before we finished the meeting. So very good example of working very closely with our providers to do better for our public.
Okay, I still have 5 minutes. So I'm gonna take three questions and squash them all into one. And what I'm basically doing, my apologies to the people who wrote the three questions in advance, but this is moderator's prerogative. I have a question about cannabis used by parents and infant deaths. I have a question about heroin use. Are you concerned about infant deaths? I have a question about cigarette use and quitting cigarette use and child death. Let's talk about substance abuse one more time and see what you guys think about those.
I was just going to run down the list. Yes.
All right, so
this is in particular, and I think Judge Walker can bear this out, We have a growing epidemic of heroin use. Heroin and methamphetamines are the scourge of society this day and time. And because we're getting a handle on issues around prescription drug abuse, it is now becoming almost impossible for people to continue to afford to buy on the black market the pills that they've become addicted to. So being opiate addicted, they turn to a very cheap form of opiate, which is heroin. And that is rearing its head throughout the state, but in particular up the I-75 corridor going north.
If you look at our asthma data for our state, you should really be concerned. Cigarette smoking is a major contributor for asthma. We also have ozone days where we have bad air that's an issue for asthma. But keep in mind that children who live with constant stress are going to have very serious asthma and allergic, even skin kinds of problems. So I think that cigarette smoking in children is something that is extremely serious, and I have no qualms about ordering parents to stop smoking, particularly when I've reviewed a child's medical records and see chronic problems with the respiratory system. As to marijuana, we have a bad habit of saying, oh gee, it's just marijuana. Great, but you know it's not legal in Georgia. And how many times do you actually know somebody who just smokes marijuana? It just doesn't work that way. And we have to talk about the elephant in the room and alcohol. We do not do a good job of screening for fetal alcohol syndrome and FASD, and they are very real. And they are often our parents, and it's multi-generational. So substance abuse is a chronic problem in juvenile court. It is a chronic problem with abuse and neglect. It's a chronic problem with deaths of children. But it's compounded by the mental health complexities. We know that depression is much more likely as part of postpartum, and we don't do a good job of serving that population, screening for that, and providing the appropriate services. And in the 1980s, when we did community-based mental health, we did not think about the consequences that we have parents who are schizophrenic, who are schizoaffective disorder, who are bipolar with psychosis, who are rearing their children, and have periods where they are extremely unsafe. And they wear their families out, and we have no safety nets for those children.
Can I just add methadone, because that's one that nobody addresses. I recognize it's legal, but I am going to say that we have reviewed deaths, and that has been a contributing factor. So it is not one to leave off the table of consideration of an issue.
One of the prevention methods with methadone is subpoenaing the clinic's records and having the doctor testify as to why they are increasing the dosage during the pregnancy. We went from 4 to 5 methadone-addicted children per year to none by subpoenaing the records and forcing the doctors to testify.
We are seeing more and more in our enforcement efforts drug driving as much as we do drunk driving. And I predict probably in the next 5 years, drug driving will eclipse drunk driving in this state. We have had to train drug recognition experts. These are police officers who put people through a battery of tests, everything from their temperature, their pulse, their eyes, eye movement, and they are about 95% accurate in identifying the family of drugs that these people are using. We spend a lot of time and effort to get them trained. We don't have them as widely spread in some rural parts of the state, and it's a tough problem. We're doing everything that we can, and it is a real problem, folks. We can tell, we have the old tried and true, when they've been drinking, you can smell it on them. But you look at somebody and they're not, you don't smell anything, and you look at their eyes and they're dilated. And sometimes, folks, they do have children in the car. One of the things I always stand out when I first got this job, went out riding with the state patrol one night, they caught somebody who was drugged driving, and they said, and there were children in the car, they said, is there a car? They said, call my mom. And mama was in a hotel with another guy, and she asked how long we'd be there because they just checked in. It about killed me. It was an eye-opener. It happens every day in the state.
On that happy note.
Sorry.
That's why you're here. So I know we're right at 5 o'clock. So I would like, you have this room full of people who give a darn. And so if you could each just say one thing that you want us to do to help with this process, whether it involves data or advertising or lobbying or anything, everybody gets to say one quick thing that you want us to do.
My quick thing is that we work really hard on suicide prevention. I thought I had seen the youngest suicide victim at 9, but our youngest this year is 7.
If you do nothing else, please talk to everybody you know about the dangers of co-sleeping with children. I think that is the area that is saddest to me, because every time I see a rollover death, I know that that was extremely preventable just by having the child sleeping on a separate surface.
And along that same line, talk to grandmothers that you know, because the source of sleeping on their stomach, put that baby on their stomach, it's going to choke, is in grandmothers. So encourage everyone. You can go to the website for public health, and it'll give you the release of the data that shows that the business about sleeping on your stomach really, really isn't safe, and sleeping on your side is not safe. So be sure and tell everyone you know, especially grandmothers and grandmothers.
Well, there is kind of a theme here today, obviously, with respect to the sleep-related death issues, and I'm happy that that's a theme, because I really, again, think that's one area that we can make some significant and profound changes over the next few years in preventing child deaths. What I would ask you to do is we're trying to provide some resources that will be helpful in raising public awareness, and one of the big resources is the videotape and PSA that's now up on the websites and that's now available to all of you. What I would ask you to do is take that with all of the networks that we have in this room. If you would take that, put it on your social media, share it with the people in your networks, show it at meetings, do whatever you think would be effective in order to help with that, and help us distribute that to other people. Because what we want to do over the next year and a half, is essentially blitz all of the different outlets or whatever we have available to us in terms of resources to get that public awareness raised on this issue of safe sleep. And we would really hope to appreciate the help of everybody in this room with respect to that. Thank you.
Take a video with you, share it with people, and unless they're in a drunken stupor, they'll be a believer after they've used it.
If you need any training, any presentations, any five-minute blurbs of this information to anyone, church groups, school groups, your organizations, Jody and I, between us, have spoken in all parts of the state, all times of day, weekends, nights, to anyone and everyone that will listen, because we have got to continue to let people know this really happens. My kids are in elementary school, and parents at that school argue with me and say, oh, honey, you don't know what you're talking about. I'm not a person to argue with, because I argue back. So, please utilize OCA. Anything we can do to help you speak to people, we're more than happy to.
I promise I won't be any doubter this time. I want to say, there's one person not here today, and we're in their house, and that's the Georgia State Patrol. And I want to tell you that we are the only state in the union that every road trooper in this state is a Safe Kids certified National Child Passenger Safety Technician, and that's something to be proud of. And I want to say, they're also trained in things like human trafficking, which involves young people as well. And they look for those things. They are a lot of times our first line of contact, particularly on the interstate highways, and they are a great partner, and I couldn't get away without saying a word about them. Thank you very much.
let's thank our panelists one more time. They're awesome. And we're honored and pleasant to know continuous, endless work, which a lot of us get to see maybe a little closer than some, but it is an impressive bunch of people here. So the other thing I wanted to give a quick shout out and shameless advertising for our legislative reception, which is going to be on February 9th. And we are honoring the Office of the Child Advocate because she argues back. But it'll be the meeting from 5 to 7, and we hope that you all will register and attend so we know how many snacks to have, et cetera. And Children's Day for us is the March 8th, I think, folks. I can't keep the number in my head for very long. March 8th at the State House on the second floor, and more shameless advertising. I'm sorry, you guys, but it's how we all get here. Sign up for our legislative updates. They come out weekly. We also have this totally humiliating 2-minute tape video thing that we do that is embarrassing, but people seem to enjoy it, and it's a total shameless piece. Thank you for coming. Be safe going home, and feel free to reach out to any of us. Thanks. Thank you.